many of us have heard the story of the three ladies who got together? And the one lady said, "I'm having a terrible time with my memory." She said, "I'll stand in front of the refrigerator with a jar of mayonnaise." And she said, "I can't remember if I need to put the mayonnaise in the refrigerator or make a sandwich." The other lady said, "Well, if you think that's bad," she said, "I'll find myself on the landing of the stairs." And she says, "I can't remember whether I should go upstairs or go downstairs." The other lady said, "Whew, boy," she said, "I'm glad I don't have your memory problems. Knock on wood." And she stopped and she said, "Did you hear that?" She said, "Wait for a moment, I need to go to the door and answer." We laugh a little bit, but our memories do concern us, and they do intrigue us, don't they? Especially when it comes to memory loss. That's why all those soap operas always have somebody who has amnesia. How many of you noticed that? Our memories and the loss of them are very, very important to us. I remember interacting with a fellow student at Bible College, and Troy had a traumatic car accident. And I was just intrigued as he shared how he lost all of his childhood memories. He could remember nothing before the time of the accident. And so it was interesting to talk to him and to get some sort of insight into how he knew who he was and the things he remembers. And the things that he remembered were only those things that others had told him about himself before the accident. In fact, there's a great deal of scientific research on memory loss and amnesia. Did you know this? This is what I found in researching for this morning sermon. Did you know that there are two basic types of amnesia? Retrograde amnesia and anterograde amnesia. Did you know that? Retrograde amnesia is classified as the loss of memory before a certain date, usually caused by an accident or some sort of trauma. Anterograde amnesia is the inability to create new memories. Now just think what that would be like in either of those instances. Now there are other forms of amnesia as well. There's dissociative amnesia, that's a loss of memory around a particularly stressful or traumatic event. In other words, there's some trauma in your life and you can't remember it anymore. And then there's this. Repeat this after me if you want a tongue twister. You want to impress people when you return home after church and say, "I learned this." There is transient global amnesia. Isn't that something? And that's a loss of all memory except for the last few moments. Causes are unknown, and some suggest that it's has to do with an epileptic event or a migraine event or maybe restrictive blood flow to the brain. And finally, there's Korsakoff's amnesia, which has to do with a thiamine deficiency, most often caused by alcohol abuse. Now here's the good news. Amnesia is really rare. Contrary to the soap opera, amnesia is very rare. But now here's the bad news. I want to suggest this morning that spiritual amnesia is rampant. Bad news is that spiritual amnesia is much more common. And if you think about it, we're busy running to and fro, we're caught up in the rat race, and we lose track of our spiritual bearings, don't we? How many people do we see that happening in our lives? Or we get distracted by something, or we focus so much on accomplishing this goal or that goal that we lose track of our spiritual bearings, we lose track of our relationship with God. It's very, very common. I've shared before, but I've seen it time and again. I continue to see it. Most people don't outright reject God. Most people don't outright reject their faith. But what occurs is a process of getting distracted, getting caught up in all sorts of other things, and they just kind of fade away. They just kind of fade away. And so sometimes I'll call folks and I'll say, "Well, what's happened? What's your relationship with God doing?" "You know, I need to do that, but I'm just so busy. There's just so many things in my life. And, oh, I didn't mean that. Nothing happened in church. Nobody said anything. I just got distracted. in our religious life, so much of them are habit, and you get out of the habit after a while, and you fill it with other things, and pretty soon you're wandering far afield. So I want to suggest this morning that spiritual amnesia is pretty common. We see it in our midst, and we all have to struggle with it. And I want to suggest that our psalm for today gives us some clues, an antidote, if you will, to keep us kind of grounded, to keep our spiritual memories. So if Cheryl, do you have the scripture, if you want to pull that up? Psalm 63 is our psalm for the summer. Now, the ascription is to David. Remember, those ascriptions, we're not sure whether they're true. It certainly fits. The background, at least, is the person who put the ascription there, is that David was probably fleeing Saul. He's out in the wilderness, right? And so this is what he's saying. But I think for this morning's purposes, that it does give you and me just the real sense of how to keep our spiritual memories. And it begins in verse 1. Verse 1 says, "O God, you are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh pants for you." The psalmist reminds us that we need to be intentional about our faith. And sometimes we think that faith just kind of happens. That there's a lightning bolt from the sky that comes down. That it's just that inner dimension that we experience. It just kind of happens to us. But the psalmist reminds you of me that we need to be intentional about our faith. He says that I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you. In fact, if you go through the verbs, look at this strong emotional content. Seeking and thirsting and fainting. Looking upon, right? And praising and blessing and lifting up hands and meditating on and clinging. These are all strong verbs that remind you and me that we need to be intentional about our faith. We need to develop those spiritual habits that kind of keep us grounded and heading in the right direction. What sort of things keep you grounded? How are you intentional about your faith? How are you intentional about seeking God on a daily, ongoing basis? Do you have time set aside to read your Bible? Is there time set aside for prayer? Is there time for worship? What do you do each and every day that kind of keeps your memory grounded, that kind of centers you spiritually in the faith that's so important to so many of us so we don't wander away? The psalmist reminds us what we need to do. We need to seek. We need to be intentional. And then he continues, "So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory." Now, the psalmist reminds us, and we've seen time again as we work through the psalm, the importance of worship. Worship is one of those events that keeps us grounded. Now, do we only need to worship in a sanctuary? It's kind of demonstrated this morning, isn't it? You can worship God wherever you are. You can worship God wherever you are. Can you worship God in the car? Yes. Can you worship God on a walk? Yes. So we need to be intentional, but worship is one of those things that also keeps our memory intact. So what sort of worship experiences do you have on a daily basis? Is there a song that's important to you? Music's so essential. Is there a song? Is there a radio station? What sort of things do you do to kind of keep you grounded, to keep you worshiping? This psalmist reminds us of the importance of that. And he says in the sanctuary, what sort of special places do you have where you worship God or you commune with God? The Celts used to say there are thin places. That is, there are thin places in the world where seemingly God's transcendent is very close. In the Bible, you often find that in mountains. There's that sense of holiness. So where is a place for you or a couple of places where you really connect with God? That's a place that can keep you grounded. I've got a good friend who finds it on a deer stand. He lives on a wonderful piece of property, and so when he's kind of losing track, when he's seeking God, he goes up and he climbs up in a tree and he talks to God. He says that people probably think he's crazy if they walk by, but he's talking to God. So what is that place for you? What's that quiet place? Is it a special room in your house? Is it a place where you walk? Is it on the rail trail? Is it a mountain? Where is that place? That's one of those things that can keep you grounded. We need to worship. We need to find those places that keep us grounded. But Bible scholars also remind us that the psalmist here is likely looking back at something that happened in his past for strength in the present. That's the way faith often is, isn't it? Some have defined faith as believing forward what only makes sense in reverse. So we need to remember those special times, those thin places, those special moments where God touches us and use them as a source of strength as we go throughout our faith. Because as we've seen time and again, you've heard me repeat it, you're sick of hearing it, but tough times come in life. And so you need to remember the good times and draw strength on them and say, boy, God was faithful then. I'm not feeling God right now. I'm going through rough times, but I know God was faithful back then, and I'm going to continue in faith forward so that sometime I can look back and through all of that see that God was faithful. Faith is often believing forward what only makes sense in reverse. How many folks know that is a truth? We know that in relationships, don't we? Sometimes in our closest relationships, we have difficulties. Sometimes we want to wring one another's necks. You know what I'm talking about? Sometimes you go, I'm not feeling all that love. But you got to remember those good times in the past and let them strengthen you for those forward moments. It's the same in our relationship with God. So when are some of those times in your life when God was really present that you can think of and say, wow, God was there. Hold on to that then, amen. Affirm it. Because there may come times where you need to go back on it. The psalmist reminds you and me. See, we have to remind ourselves of those sorts of things over and over again. I just returned from a global leadership summit. It's an impressive name, and really just a gathering of clergy. But there was an interesting, and the gentleman there said this. He observed this. He said, how many of us know about Coke? How many of us know what Coke is? Coca-Cola. Okay, not that kind of Coke. Coca-Cola. We often say Coke, but yeah, the other Coke, I can understand why nobody raised their hand. How many of us know Coca-Cola? Everybody knows it. Why does Coca-Cola spend billions of dollars on advertising if you already know what their product is? To keep you reminded. To keep you reminded of their product. It's the same way in our spiritual life. We need to look back. So one more of some of those times in your life where God was close, you need to remind yourself of that this morning so you can keep your memory. Or you need to grab a hold of one of those things today so in the future you can continue forward knowing that someday you'll look back and see God's hand. So the psalmist reminds us of that. He says, I've looked back upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your glory because of your steadfast love, the veteran. Out of that flows worship again, right? So I'll bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands. I mean, worship's often that, right? You come in Sunday morning, you go, I don't want to worship. Some of you are probably feeling that this morning. Maybe some of you young people are going, oh, Mom dragged me here. Dad dragged me here, right? But you come in, you may not feel it, but you go, man, God touched me back then, so I'm going to continue to worship, trusting that somewhere along the line, this worship thing is going to be meaningful or more meaningful. So the psalmist praises all that. Then he continues, right? Verse 6, he says, when I think of you on my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night, for you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy. The psalmist ends every day going over in his mind what God has done during the day. Wonderful practice, isn't it? How many of us at the end of the day just pause and say, God, where were you? Where were you in my life? Giving thanks. In fact, some say that maybe the psalmist is suffering from insomnia. Any of us have that? Nobody has it here. You don't have trouble with insomnia. Some do. And so in those moments where we have trouble with insomnia, he said he just goes back and he meditates on God. What a wonderful practice to keep our memories intact and grounded. At the end of each day, do you stop and pause, maybe kneel at your bed or before you get in bed, maybe you're brushing your teeth, you say, God, Father, you were there today. Thank you. I'm going to meditate on what you've done. Wonderful practice. And so the psalmist gives you and me ways that we can stay grounded. And out of that, it puts life in perspective. He goes on to say, yeah, these enemies are going to be destroyed. In that memory, he now has the assurance that God's justice is ultimately going to come. their life will be set right in the future, and he continues to hold on that and live into the future, knowing that sometimes it'll only make sense in reverse. Powerful, powerful psalm. A little story kind of captures everything, and I'd like to wrap up with it. It's the story of Chief Forget-Me-Not. How many have heard this story? A gentleman, a travel writer from Australia, was going to go into Canada and develop research, get some research for an upcoming article, and so he landed in Vancouver and stayed at the Vancouver Hilton. As they came down in the morning, there was a native over in the corner, and so he said to the gal at the desk, he said, "Who is that?" She said, "Oh, that is Chief Forget-Me-Not. He's a very important chief. In fact, the hotel is built on his land, so he can come here any day, and he's often here each and every morning. He's an incredible person, 92 years old, and he can remember almost every detail of his life." So the Aussie went up and he said, "Good day, mate." He said, "I want to ask you a question. What did you eat for breakfast on your 21st birthday?" And she said, "Eggs." Of course, the Aussie was impressed. He had his travels to do, so he left. And as he traveled throughout Canada, he reminded people of his great chief in Vancouver, Chief Forget-Me-Not. And he said he has an incredible memory. And as he shared his story with one of his fellow Canadians, and then he didn't greet the chief in a proper, appropriate way. He said, instead of saying, "Good day, mate," he said, "You should say how." And so he continued his travels, and he was excited because he knew he would be flying out of Vancouver and staying in the same hotel, and he hoped that he would see the chief there when he got there. Sure enough, in the morning before he flew off, there was Chief Forget-Me-Not, and so he went up to him at once, and he said, "How?" And the chief said, "Scramble." Look, we have memories like that, spiritual memories, right? The psalmist gives you and me some clues how to keep our memories intact. Gives us some very strong clues on how to keep our memories intact. He reminds you and me that we have to be intentional about it. It's not just going to happen. We have to develop those godly habits. One of them is worship, right? Finding those special places where God is close and reveals himself to us. Remembering those past events where God was really with us, maybe got us through a tough time, and drawing strength from them. He reminds us of all that. He reminds us of the importance of worship. He reminds us how each day we should end looking back and saying, "God, where were you?" Or maybe even admitting, "I can't see you, Lord, but I thank you for the day that I just had." He reminds us of all of those things keep us and our faith strong. And we have not only a forget-me-not faith, and we have a forget-me-not God faith. The psalmist gives us some clues how to have that. Let's pray. Gracious and loving Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness to us in the past. We thank you for this opportunity to worship you. We thank you for your goodness revealed to us in the past. We thank you for the hope we have in the future. And we admit at times, Lord, we know not what the future holds, but we know who holds it. And we live into it trusting in your faithfulness that has been revealed to each of us. That's why we're here. So, Lord, help us to have strong spiritual memories, to not forget your goodness, to be intentional about our faith, and to live it out so that we might not be one of those people that just kind of wanders away or has lackluster spirituality, but that we might have that deep, abiding faith that David had, or whoever wrote this psalm had, when they say, "I seek you, I thirst for you, I yearn for you, I want you and you alone, Lord." Let us have such faith. We pray and ask this in Jesus' most precious name.